Good evening, viewers. Welcome to People and Stories. I'm your host, Jackie Narubama. Tonight, we have a very interesting guest, Lena Pira. She came to Uganda as a missionary, but she branched into publishing. Let's hear how she moved from the pulpit to books.
Hi, Jackie. Thank you so much for having me. It's great to be here.
Thanks for accepting.
Yes.
Now you're talking about getting soft copies, yeah? Getting these books online.
Yes.
You see, we here in Uganda and Africa, we still have trouble with our internet connection and all.
Yeah.
Now for any budding writer, even a good one, they would wonder, is it really feasible to have to get my book online and print as well? Can't I have one and not the other? What's in it for me to have it both ways?
Yeah, I think it's important to have it both ways. The statistics coming out of Africa is that e-books are growing because our network is growing, the digital network is growing. And so what they're saying is in Africa, 53% are actually reading e-books and 47% are reading print. So it's a very, you know, even balanced half-half kind of thing. The younger people and those that are very mobile and travel, they tend to prefer ebooks. One, they prefer it because they can move with maybe 100 libraries in their phones. But two, ebooks tend to be slightly cheaper. And so young people prefer to access on their phones and get a discount where they're not, you know, having to lug a book around. So you target a different market when you target ebooks. The older generation still is interested in print, but also, you know, people that have, you know, low access to internet or they might not have smartphones, they're also interested in the print. So they're two diverse different markets. And what I find is some people like me, when I get a print book, if I really love it, I'll buy an ebook edition as well. Because you know why? When I love a book, I'll probably read it and give it to my friend who's also going to read it, and I might not get that book, but I want my other copy that sticks with me forever. So I tend to usually have both copies myself.
Now, since as a publisher, you deal with many people, the author, the editors, designers. I mean, how do you juggle all that?
It's interesting. Every book is its own beast, I would say. So, for instance, we do some illustrated children's books. We have an illustrator that we work with. We have a team of editors. But every book is its own. So what's interesting right now, I'm working on, I'd say, about 8 books at the moment.
Whoa, at once?
At once. So I might find that yesterday I worked on editing one. Once I'm done with an editing thing, I'm going to send it back to the author who's going to review it. As the author is taking their week to review, I'm going to work on another one. The next day, I'm going to send those edits to another author who's going to spend a week working on it. Then this day, I might spend time designing covers.
How big is your brain?
Very big. But so our team, we all work in collaboration. And we juggle all of them so that, you know, you might find our publishing house launches a book today, it launches another book next week, it launches another book the week after. So we can be launching because we are working on several projects all at once. As the illustrator is illustrating, the editor can be editing, you know, or in, as the marketing person is designing little promotional things for a new book being launched, another person is proofreading. So We work together as a collaboration.
Okay, I was actually asking about egos because managing people is not easy.
Yes.
And
yes.
Now you have a diverse team full of talent.
Yes.
The illustrator is talented that way, and you pass it back to the author, and then the author feels affronted. How can she remove this? This is the best bit of the book.
It happens all the time, by the way.
So how do you navigate through that?
We sit and we go back and forth. There's been several books that we've worked on where we say, okay, let's edit it. We've edited it. And then the author is like, no, actually, I want my things in there. We had one author who they wrote like they talked versus, you know, there's written English and spoken English. So their book was written how you would converse. So there was all these little nuances that are not normally in a print book. So our editor went through, and tried to clean it up. And when they cleaned it up, the author was like, no, put my things back in. Put all the things back in. And we told the author at the beginning, just let's write something that this is intentional, because we don't want it to distract a reader, because if you don't make any note of it, they're going to either think the editor was bad or the publisher didn't know what they're doing. So we find that we tend to put in notices like, by the way, this was intentionally written in conversational English and not, you know. So we did do that for that book. Other books, we go back and forth and we find a happy medium where we both agree. Other books, you know, we just agree to disagree and we go with, you know, either. Most of the time, if we really don't agree about something, we tend to go with what the author wants, because we are a self-publishing company, where that means that the author is paying for services. It's not the same as a traditional publisher. A traditional publisher pays the author, but also has more of the say of how the book turns out, because they've been the one who invests in the book. And so a traditional setting, the publisher usually takes the strong arm and says, this is...
Oh, the author just hands over manuscript.
Exactly. Because it's a contract between the two. But the publisher, because they're taking the financial risk, have more of the say. They also share the royalties with the author. But in a self-publishing world, ultimately, you've hired me. I will advise you as best as I can. But if you don't want to take my advice, I'll still do what you want done, because you're paying for the service. So that's the difference between self-publishing and traditional publishing. You know, at times, there's been times where we're like, okay, we as a publisher might not agree with this. We'll let them know. If we don't feel so comfortable, we might not put our name on the book, but we'll still help you publish it. So there's times where we've known that we've removed our name from the copyright and not associated our company with the book, because the author didn't take advice, but the author paid for it, so we don't hold back our services. So there's many different nuances to that, but it's just being wise in how you deal with people, because every person is different, every book is different. Yes.
So since you came to Uganda first on a mission, mm-hmm. then you returned to fully work in a church, and then now you're here as a publisher. If someone walked up to you, an author, with a book that is more or less inclined towards the unchristian, you know, an unchristian theme, mm-hmm. would you be willing to publish?
Well,
or would you find the conflict within you?
There's, I would say yes and no.
Okay.
Yes. How so? Because AfricanBooks.com is an ebook platform where we accept Christian and non-Christian content. We want it to be mainly Christian content because we want it to be an evangelical outreach tool for pastors and things like that to share the good news. But we accept all books because we are not going to have non-Christians come in and read our content if we don't put books that also to appeal to them. So we put all content there so that we can appeal to all and win a few.
Okay.
That's a Bible verse. But two, as a publisher, we tend to do, when we're doing editing work and all that, we don't always take on non-Christian content. Because it takes a lot more time and effort for us to do editing and all that. We could spend a year on a book, and we want to make sure that we're okay with what we're putting out there. So we don't publish work that is directly in opposition to what our Christian beliefs are as a publisher, because we are a Christian publishing house. So we have had, you know, other faiths come and they want to publish, and we've still given them prices, but they actually have not come back to us because they're like, they are Christian.
Oh, because you let them know.
Yeah, we told them we are a Christian publisher, these are our beliefs, da da da. And some people choose not to use us, even though we are good, because they're like, she's a Christian. Yeah, we are not Christians. So, but we have done academic textbooks before. We have done content that is not directly Christian, but not in opposition. We won't do anything that's in opposition to Christianity. That's what I would say. So, yeah, because my goal as a missionary, I didn't come to Uganda per se to become a businesswoman. I came to Uganda to make change, yeah, and bring change and bring the gospel. So I that's what I tend to subscribe to. Yes, yes. Yeah.
So far, tell us, when you started LEAP, huh? Coming into publishing, what challenges did you find?
Well, I didn't register LEAP for quite some time. In 2014 is when I got the idea, but I didn't actually register the company for many years later. Yes, I was just kind of doing pro bono stuff because I wanted to understand the missional aspect of what I was doing. Because I told God, I came as a missionary, not necessarily a businesswoman. I want to understand your heart in this business before I start the business. So that is what really took me a long time before I registered, because I wanted to make sure I was in line with what God was calling me to do in Uganda.
Did you have to first hear His voice? Yes. Pronounce that.
I had to understand how it impacted people for Christ. And actually, it's called LEAP Publishers because it's based on taking a leap of faith. Yeah, because all of us, even when you go to put yourself out there as an author, you're taking a leap of faith of putting your story out there, putting yourself out there. You know, it's a scary thing, eh? The same for us when we were starting the publishing house. And then also I had to transition my brain to, you know what, I'm a missionary to now I'm an employer. In Uganda, that has taken a lot. I've had to learn a lot about, you know, how to be an employer, what are the laws of Uganda, how do they work, how do we pay our taxes, how do we do all those things. So we have started slowly so that we can do everything right and so that we can build a proper publishing house. So we are, you know, going step by step. I'm constantly asking people. I ask the accountant, okay, how do we do this thing? How do we pay taxes? How do we pay NSSF? How do we do this? So I have had to learn all those things because I first came as a missionary and I wasn't even earning income in Uganda. So at all, I came as a volunteer. So for like 10 years, I wasn't actually on even a work permit that I could earn income. So I was really doing volunteer work. So it has been such a transition just for me personally into now I'm an employer, I'm employed, I employ myself, I'm also a missionary, you know, so that has been a beautiful transition for me.
Do you still have time to do mission work?
I do a lot of it. I'd say probably 50% of my time is spent doing church-related content or missionary work, and the other 50% is within the company. But the beautiful thing is, I see LEAP as a missionary. I see African Books as also a missionary thing, because African Books, we don't charge. We have developed all of that site free of charge. We have spent our money to develop it. And if you as an author say, I have a book, I want to put it on there, we just tell you, create your account and put it there, it's free. Go ahead, because we want to build this African library for everyone. So what I do every day,
it's very noble.
Yeah, is missionary work. Yeah.
Let's go for a break. We'll be right back. Welcome back from the break. We're still here with Lena Pira, a publisher and a missionary. Now, when I meant, what I meant with challenges, I thought, you know, like any industry, okay, I don't know about publishing,
yes,
you'll tell us,
yes,
but people will tell you, say, in the music industry, when there's a newbie, someone new in the market,
yes,
getting in,
yes,
they find some resistance, mm-hmm, so.
We've not found resistance. What we have, what we've really tried to work hard for, I won't find staff and employees that have my heart, because I want them to see the missional side of the company first and the heart behind the company before I just hire anyone. So our challenges have really been in hiring, yeah, human resource, making sure we have the right people for our development team of the platform, our editing team, you know, all those, to find people of excellence with the same heart that I carry. That has been the biggest challenge. But in terms of like the publishing world, because I have that heart of I want to help people, I work with publishers. I don't work in opposition to them. And so like even AfricanBooks.com, we are working with Fountain to put their books on that platform. So we are trying to create a solution for all of us so that we all work together versus working in opposition. So my ebook platform can help Fountain. They won't have to develop their own. My ebook platform can help, you know, any publisher. They can use it. I think at the moment we're working with 10 different publishers for that platform, and we want to work with every publisher in Africa. And so I think it's made it easy because my heart is to give. It's not to compete.
Okay.
You get. So I think
that's made it a lot easier.
All right. You seem to have a very strong Christian foundation. Have you been Christian all your life?
I grew up in church. I wouldn't say I became a Christian when I was a child. I was always constantly like, my dad was not a Christian, is not a Christian, and my mom is. And so I was constantly looking at both sides and I'm like weighing it, right? But around the age 17 is when I actually became a Christian and I professed Christ. And I remember I was so confused at the time when I did it that I did it when I was in my bedroom. And so I went in my room. I was so frustrated with life. Things seemed to be so hard. I was, you know, like life seemed to be, I was tired.
Right? At 17.
At 17, you can imagine. I think if I had not found God, I am sure I would have become an atheist. I was so annoyed with church and politics within church because I grew up in a Baptist church. I was constantly seeing like what people were saying was not what they were living. And that's what frustrated me a lot. So I was constantly, I was in this battle. So I was frustrated. But I had this thing, I guess being in a Baptist church, I was like, but I don't want to go to hell, you know? Like, so I went in my bedroom. I remember it forever. I laid on my bed and I told God, you know what, God, everyone says you exist. The Buddhists say God exists. The Muslims say God exists. The Baptist church say you exist. Me, I have no peace. If you exist, give me peace. I want peace. If you don't give me peace, I'm going to tell everyone you don't exist. I was so bold in that prayer. It scares me to think about it today. The way I went to God was so like, you know, I was done. Eh?
That's the honesty he
craved. So I went to him like that. I'll tell you, I had an experience in that room. Peace flooded over me. I felt like God is actually himself giving me a hug. I couldn't move for over an hour. And I started repenting from there on out because the hug was such a tight, firm, like washing of peace that I felt like, okay, is God mad that I spoke to him like that? Please, God, don't squeeze me too hard and squeeze me to death. Like, don't squeeze, pop out my eyeballs. But, oh, wow, this is peace. Okay. I do believe you exist, and that was my, you know, walking into real life and real belief with God, and that's where it started from, and since then I constantly rely on him, you know, to guide me, to lead me, to lead my paths where I want to go, because I find that I can be in the world, but when I was in the world, I had no satisfaction with the world. So me, I want to live a life of purpose where I'm constantly satisfied. I'm not the kind of person that you will bribe me with cars, houses, you know, money. I won't. I'll say, is God in it? If God's in it, I'll do it. If God's not there, I don't care how much you offer me. You can offer me $20 million. I'll say no. Because it doesn't appeal to me. I know that other side, and I know what it comes with, and it's not enticing to me.
Christians are wont to always say things like you just said, purpose. Mm-hmm. Please elaborate what purpose is, because ultimately we all feel we have a purpose to achieve, but when a Christian tells you, I purpose to wait on God, I'm waiting for purpose, for his purpose for my life. How do you know that this is it. Because he gave you many talents, first of all. There you are in a mission, now you're publishing. So at what point do you understand his purpose, soul purpose?
There's a lot of little checkpoints and guiding lights, I think, along the way. I could say that when I came to Uganda, I didn't really fully know what I was coming to. All I knew was God wants me in Uganda. That's all I knew. I didn't know, am I going to be a school teacher? Am I going to write curriculum? Am I just going to be in church? I didn't know. But I knew a little bit. And it's kind of like God gives you clues along the way. And he won't give you a big picture all at once because it'll scare you. You'll run away and be like, God, that's too big for me. So for me, God always gave me little checkpoints along the way. He guided my footsteps. So when I got to Uganda, that's when I ended up entering into curriculum. That's when the door opened for curriculum. Once I stepped into curriculum, that's when he opened up the next door for publishing or for designing books. First, he taught me how to design books and, you know, edit and all those different things. I learned it at my job in GABA, actually. They put me in communications for a while, so I had to learn how to design adverts and things like that. Taught me how to design covers eventually. So as I got to that point, the next point comes books. I said, okay, I see God in this. Let me say yes to help one person. When I helped that one person, it opened another door to the next thing. And amazingly enough, after 9 years, I felt God impress upon me that I had not yet started. And I was thinking to myself, 9 years? God, I've not yet started? What are you talking about? But the truth was, I hadn't yet started. It's, I think, at year 11 that I actually started African Books and Leap Publishers. So all that time was preparation. And there were so many options for me to be deterred along the way that I really had to say, I want to see God in everything I choose. People tried to bribe me out of Uganda. My own father wanted me to go and work for him in the US and offered me all kinds of things to leave Uganda. And my heart knew, you know, you're supposed to be in Uganda. And every time I searched him out and asked God, what's the next step? He always gave it to me. And so sometimes people are mistaken to say, God, I need to see the big picture. I need to know everything up front. You don't actually need to know everything up front. You just need to know each step. It's like eating a cake. You're not going to eat it in one big gulp. You're going to eat it one bite at a time, right? So God is wise enough to give us steps. It says, the Bible says that man plans his ways, but God directs his steps. So that's the thing. And every year I've learned new things. Actually, I did research about my family maybe about 4 or 5 years ago, and I learned that I wasn't the first missionary of my family.
Really?
But going into missions, I never knew that I was not the first. I thought I was the first. I discovered I had a missionary relative who came to British East Africa, which was Kenya, 1905, and spent 50 years in Kenya as a missionary. I didn't even know. So sometimes we are walking a path that God has planned for us before our birth. I mean, you can imagine 1905. This person is in British East Africa, and you know, here comes Lena in 2009, and I actually discovered I was doing a similar thing that my relative was doing. 100 years later, she was writing content and doing translations for Christian content for before Kenya was even, you know, hit India. Yeah, before Kenya was Kenya. So, I mean, sometimes God has, the Bible says that God has ordained us for something when we were in our mother's wombs. It's the process of purpose is to discover that along the way. And it's such a beautiful thing. You'll know when you're not in purpose because you'll feel something in your spirit that says there's more. When I was in California, I had a good job. But something inside of me kept saying, there's more. I'm missing something, there's more. When I go to Uganda, even though I didn't know the whole picture yet, and I'd say I still probably don't know the whole picture yet, I see, like, I know where I'm going, but I wouldn't say I probably know the ultimate. But I feel a satisfaction in it. When I wake up, I want to wake up. I'm excited to wake up because I'm like, man, God, what are you going to do today? Like, every morning I wake up, I'm like, God, this is what I planned for today. But if you have changes in the schedule, let me know. Like, that's how I live my life. So it's purpose. It really is purpose. And you can have purpose even in an employment job. You don't have to be your own boss to find purpose.
Lena, let's not even start. So, thank you, Lena.
Thank you.
Good night, viewers. This has been Lena Pira. Till next time, goodbye.